Hello, and welcome to the Art of Living Well podcast. I'm Stephanie May Potter, and I'm here with my co-host, Marnie Dotchess-Marmette.
We created the Art of Living Well podcast to empower you to live your happiest, healthiest, and most authentic life. Each week, we will bring you inspiring and motivating conversations covering health and wellness topics, including fitness, mindset, food, travel, product reviews, and strategies from a variety of experts, including our own bank of knowledge.
We are excited to educate, motivate, and inspire you to change the way you perceive health and discover your art of living well. Get ready to feel inspired.
Welcome to episode number 6 of the Art of Living Well podcast. I'm Marnie Dotchess-Marmette, and I'm here with my co-host, Stephanie May Potter. I'm so excited to introduce today's podcast guest, Mollie Krengel. I met Mollie multiple years ago when I went to one of her community dance experiences. I thought it was so much fun that I asked her to come to my house to teach me privately. She was kind enough to do that, and many years later, I then heard about Wild Bum, her travel experience company. I was so excited about what she was doing because I'm also passionate about travel, and like Mollie, I kind of dive deep into researching vacations. So we met again, and I decided to become a guide architect for Wild Bum. So Mollie, tell me how you got started with Wild Bum and Wildhive and what they mean.
All right, so I'll start with Wildhive, which began in March of 2015, where I create mini adventures all over the Twin Cities. And our conduit is music and dance, building community, and later on our big adventures, which I'll explain more later, but our group travel experiences for women. Wildhive is all about really wild celebrations. So coming together, cheering each other on. We use dance and music, as I said, to bring community together, and they're just really special experiences that are funny and fun. Those evolved into the women's trips because I'm super passionate about travel, as you said. And the start of Wild Bum was essentially I did it on my own for about a year, where people were coming to me asking for all of my travel research that I invest hours and hours, really weeks and weeks of, you know, time spent obsessing over really amazing experiences, whether it was traveling on my own for the group travel experiences or as a family with our kids in tow. So I started to put all of my research into guides, into guide formats, and offering, you know, this for people to purchase, and they did. And then that sparked the idea for Wild Bum. So building a global community through a shared passion for travel and adventure and living with more meaning. And so it is an e-commerce platform that brings guide architects, I call them. So people like me, people like Marnie and myself who obsess over the research and want to share those experiences with others so that they might not enjoy the research process or they don't have the time for it. So it's a blueprint, like a vetted blueprint of how they can create a meaningful adventure of their own.
And you have guide architects all over the world, right?
We do. We just hit our 1-year anniversary, which is exciting. Thank you. But we're still in our infancy, so we're still, well, as always, as anything in this human experience, it's hopefully we'll always continue to grow and evolve. But right now we have 300 guide architects living around the world and new travel guides being uploaded to the site all the time. So, yeah.
That's amazing.
Thank you.
So Mollie, can you tell us a little bit about Wildhive's mini and big adventures?
Yes. So the mini adventures, I call them mini adventures because our experiences together, it's hard to put them into words. They're always different, whether it's the music, the people, the space that we come together in. I really want every experience to hit every human sense. So they're really unique. I use venues all over the Twin Cities, whether it's breweries, distilleries, art galleries, wedding space, like we've been everywhere. So that's where you really get that sense of adventure. I want them to encourage people to get out of their bubbles. So we're showing up, right, in different spaces. And I think that's absolutely at the core of what we're doing.
I love that.
Yeah.
And you can do that in your own backyard, in your own city. You don't even need to necessarily leave.
Absolutely. Yeah. I know we'll touch on this later, but I've even shared with people that you can feel a sense of adventure just changing up your route you take, mm-hmm. right? Like in your car, whether it's to work or to school, you know, pick your kids up from school. I had a moment where I, you know, we walk the lakes a lot in Minneapolis. So yep. I tend to go walk my dog around the lakes, and I happened to just reverse my usual route, and I turned and went the other way. And I was like, every second I'm like, oh my gosh, I'd never noticed this before, or that, you know, it's,
yeah.
I think there are little things that we get so, we're just kind of programmed, or we get in our habits. So, you know, a lot of it is a mindset around adventure and in really infusing our everyday with that. But Wildhive, even though they happen once or twice a month, they're really meant to create this, these experiences that really spark and become a catalyst for more adventure. So anyway, I could go on and on, but that those are Wildhive. The big adventures are our group travel experiences. So taking all of the magic that we experience in a mini adventure, but going either out of the country or out of the state. We've been to Guatemala, El Salvador, Joshua Tree. We're headed to Colombia. And it's incredible. I mean, they're for women. So there's this really special dynamic. I think if I have one job besides making sure that I have done all of my research and I have everything taken care of, so people literally can just show up and know that everything's going to be okay and they're safe and we're going to have an amazing time. But my one like priority is to cultivate an atmosphere of encouragement and support. It's a big decision to go on a group travel experience, to leave the country, especially for people who don't travel often, and to go with people they don't know, because not everyone knows one another. And it is magical. It's just like we celebrate one another, we cheer each other on, and you have this opportunity where you can come not as how you identify as home, being a mom, a wife, a sister, a friend. You just come and you are you. You can just be you, and it's a beautiful thing.
Oh, absolutely. And so many people really need that right now. So many women in particular.
Definitely.
Look, what are the ages of the travelers and the people that typically come on these big adventures?
Yes. And I think for it, it's actually the same for, well, so the mini adventures, I'll just throw in there. It's all ages, men and women. I have a father-daughter duo who come, and I just adore them.
That's so cute.
It's amazing. Thing together. It's incredible. And I have kids who come. I mean, it's definitely, you know, created for teenage into adulthood, where we really need to bring that sense of play back into our lives. The big adventures are women in their 20s to women in their 60s and everything in between. So it's just, it's wonderful how it doesn't matter where you're at in your life. We're all at different stages, and we come together for this week. Columbia's 10 days, but we come together for the, you know, however many days it is. And we just, I get emotional thinking about it, because it's just a really cool experience that people have with one another that's pretty life-changing and kind of creates these bonds that last a lifetime. So.
Oh, I'm sure.
I definitely want to come on one of those trips as soon as I can at some point.
Can't wait.
So speaking of play, how would you suggest a person adds play and adventure into their life, like more on a daily basis and not just during travel?
Definitely. I think that really the inception of these, of my businesses have been, I've recognized things that I've needed in my own life where I needed more play. And I have really shifted the way I view parenthood, that, you know, yes, there are certain things that we are responsible for as parents, you know, in teaching manners and all these things. But like, really, we are learning so much from our kids because, right? Like, and Wildhive, Wild Bum, it's all about like, it's in there already. It's about waking it up. So, right, like play is in there, it's possibly lying dormant. So how can we shift things around, reframe our minds, where we sort of wake up that inner child? And so that's where the wild, like I think that's my obsession with the word wild, because one of the definitions of wild is our true nature. So I think it starts with mindset. You know, we have enough in life to be serious about, right? Yes. And I know in particular with Wildhive, that is, its core is, it's all about play. So it's funny. I have been to enough situations where everyone is so serious. right? And, you know, like people don't look at one another. You just, we had talked a little bit earlier about mirrors, which I'm sure we'll touch on later. But, you know, you just get so serious. You look at yourself, you start to criticize yourself, or, you know, it's, we're sort of kind of at this disconnect. So for me, play is about just, just creating an atmosphere that feels joyful and you're reminded to celebrate and that things are funny. Like we can laugh. It's a right, good thing. Yeah. And I think that once I know for myself, my goal with Wildhive is it goes beyond the 1 hour that we're together. It's a movement, if you will, where my hope is that you then apply these feelings and these experiences in your day to day, whether it's in your relationships, whether it's in the workplace. Mm-hmm. I've done some work with teenage girls where we dance and we have this amazing experience, and then we actually get to talk about it and say, how did it feel? And how can you take those feelings and how do you show up then for yourself and for your friends and your family? So it goes way beyond just a dance party. Yeah.
No, I love that. I love that. It's actually something when you talk about like laughing and having fun every day, that's really a focus of mine. Even just the last few months, it's something that I have as a goal.
Right.
Because I don't think we do it enough.
No.
And not in front of our kids, which I think for parents out there, that's really important too. So kind of adding on to that, just tell us about the beauty of getting messy and being vulnerable, which sounds like it really happens during these experiences, these mini adventures in particular, and how that can really change a person's life.
Absolutely. And I think it actually ties in really nicely with play and why so many people have maybe lost that sense of play, because with play does come vulnerability. I mean, to feel silly is to feel vulnerable, right? So it's just... I think that I know when we're dancing together, I'm very selective and intentional about the music. So I want it to feel like the music also sets the tone for play and for being silly and feeling things. And I really want it to, you know, spark something inside. And so a lot of times when we're dancing together, we talk about like, this is life. Life is messy. So it's really about how you embrace it. You don't avoid it. You know, and if things feel uncomfortable, then you don't quit.
Right. Take like, a deep breath, right? You breathe through it.
Yeah, you breathe through it, you laugh.
I think that's where the laughter comes in, mm-hmm. right? Like it's okay. And I think the more that you can find people who share that mission, you know, for adding more play and vulnerability in their lives, the more safe you feel to do it. And I think that we've learned through amazing people like Brené Brown and people whose work is really focused on play and vulnerability, we've learned that it's kind of like a muscle. And I know for myself personally, right, the more that I've created these experiences, put myself out there, tried things, failed, made tweaks and changes, the more I actually start to yearn for it. Mm-hmm. Like I yearn for the
challenge.
Right, the vulnerability, the silliness, because to me that means growth. And that's how it becomes life-changing. I am definitely not one of those people that just says, this is it. Like, this is it for me. Like, this is where I'm perfect and I'm not doing anything else. Like, no, I think that life is all about evolution and growth. And it's like those people that say, if you're not growing, you're, you know, dying. Maybe, is that how it goes? Right? Yeah.
I believe that.
Yeah. So when you can start to slow, and I think too, it's important, like as a culture, we forget that things don't need to happen drastically. It's not this total, like all of a sudden 180, or we're going to start seeing, things happen immediately, that immediate gratification. It's like, no, this can be baby steps and a process. Mm-hmm. So little by little, like you start to add some of these experiences in, or even if we talk about travel, it's like little by little, maybe you do the microcation, you know, maybe you mm-hmm. then you catch the bug and then you're like, I might go for a week. Oh my gosh. You know, like imagine a week vacation. And then meanwhile in Europe, they're like on their month long, you know?
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Businesses are shut down.
Right. Exactly.
They know how to enjoy
life
right? in a way that Americans don't know.
Yes, exactly. So I think that little by little, that's what makes all of this life-changing.
So tell me about the service component of the trips.
Yeah. So my goal, just like a mini adventure, my goal with the trips is it's that they hit every sense. So you're coming to this beautiful place. I like to tell people, like, it is the perfect combo of everything. So you get the dance, which is pretty euphoric. I mean, especially when you're dancing in these, you know, incredible locations. And it's funny, something that I didn't mention, but in our mini adventures, half of the experience is in a circle. So forget the mirrors, because that's not what this is about. This isn't about how it looks. This is taking it back to dance, like the root of dance, which is about how it feels. Mm-hmm. So there are no mirrors. We are in a circle. We're interacting with one another. We're laughing with one another. We're making eye contact. I know it sounds a little weird, but I promise you, like, it is so liberating, and no one cares what anyone else is doing. That's the atmosphere. So you take that on these big adventures. And women are just like in the circle, and we're cheering each other on, and it's funny and it's awesome. And it's just like puts you in this state of mind that's just like, I mean, I don't know how else to describe it, but euphoric. And then you add in the service component. So we are there to make a sustainable, long-lasting impact on a community. We definitely spend time with kids and go to schools, and that's wonderful. They love to dance and play, and it's awesome. But our goal is to really... I work really hard to find a project that we know will make a long-lasting impact once we've gone home.
That's amazing.
Yeah. So we've Guatemala, we purchased and installed water filters and stoves into people's homes.
Wow. Yeah. And did you guys actually physically do that?
We did.
That is
yes.
So amazing.
Yes. So we're working hard. In El Salvador, we've renovated a rural school. I partnered with a construction crew, and we built a library. We renovated the bathrooms. Like, the condition of the bathrooms you can't even imagine. Like, you walk in and we are just stunned by the, you know, the way things are. And I think something that's really important, and something that really actually also makes these trips so special, we have this reflection period at the end of each, you know, day, and we talk about with one another how crazy it is that we walk in and we feel like, oh my gosh, like, this is how they're living, but they are so happy and they're so content. Mm-hmm. And it's this like aha moment of, wow, maybe we have things a little backwards, and right, and then how can we change our day-to-day in our own lives and be more grateful, and maybe it impacts your decisions you make right at home and on a daily basis. But so we have the service project. We work really hard. And then my goal is that by 1 to 2 p.m., we are sitting with a cocktail by the pool.
So nice. I was just going to ask, what does a typical day look like? Yes, so are you dancing in the morning?
It varies.
Give us a rough idea of what a typical day would look like.
Definitely. So the time of dance depends on what we've got going on. So I usually arrange that we have like three big service days. So that means like we're getting up early, we're working hard. Now there are quite a few of us, so there's a lot we can get accomplished. Mm-hmm. So we might, you know, have a couple days where we have a longer work day, and then maybe one shorter work day, and then we usually end with like a celebration. I definitely have a few days that are free days. In El Salvador, we learned how to surf. Yeah, in Guatemala, we did a 7-mile hike, and then we all cheered each other on. We jumped off a 30-foot platform.
Oh my gosh, amazing. Yes. That is so amazing.
Yes. So there's lots of vulnerability, lots of getting out of our comfort zone on so many levels, but that is where the magic happens. Mm-hmm. And then we either dance in the morning or we dance in the evening. And sometimes as the sun is setting, we dance, and sometimes people have enjoyed a cocktail or two and things get a little wild. So you just never know, but that's what makes it so special.
Oh, I love it. It really does sound life-changing,
It is. And then dinners together, and we play games. We have game nights, which get pretty funny and rowdy. And I start the trip out with everything is optional, and usually within an hour, like that's all it takes. Within an hour, we're all just like, We just want to do everything together. Right. So we start joking. This is optional / mandatory game yeah. night. Like, you know, but it's awesome. And it's, yeah, it's pretty cool to see. Even we've had mom and daughters.
I would love to bring my mom on a trip like that, actually. Yeah. I think she would love it.
Yes. I get goosebumps just thinking about it because I've had some moms and daughters, and it's pretty remarkable, just the dynamic, but also this time with these amazing women who, mm-hmm. like, I have a mom, Sharon is her name, and she came to El Salvador, and she said this is the most fun she's had in either many, many, many years or just ever. And to hear...
I just got the chills.
Right? I know. Yes. I'm like... and that's why I keep doing it.
Oh. Yeah.
Right. I am a little, if anyone's listening to this that has been on the trips, they have to tell me, like, we're all adults, we're fine, like, stop taking care of us. And so it's a lot of work for me because I just want everyone to be so happy. But I keep doing it because of just the magic that happens between everybody.
Oh, absolutely. Well, and I can really hear your passion.
Oh, exactly. I know. So, I can keep going on and on and on, so I'm sorry I ramble a lot.
No, this is awesome.
Yeah, thank you.
So can you tell us a little bit about vitamin T I've heard you talk about before and why you prescribe it?
Absolutely. So this is too where Wildhive and Wild Bum share a common vision or mission, if you will, which is how to live with more adventure and meaning. And I truly believe it's through vitamin T, which it was a recent blog post in our editorial on Wild Bum, but travel. T stands for travel. So again, I think... A big dream is Wild Bum is part of what changes our dialogue around travel in the States, especially where we view travel not as a luxury, rather as an essential part of our health and well-being. So the number is staggering. The number of people who leave unused vacation days on the mm-hmm. table each year, Now, the science behind it, which I have, that's my background, so I geek out over the mm-hmm. science, but the science behind it is that when people do use their vacation days, they come back a better employee, right? So employers are recognizing that the importance of it, but they return taking fewer sick days, they have improved productivity, increased creativity, there's a camaraderie that happens among colleagues, they swap travel stories. I could go on and on and on with all of the benefits. So I think that I know from myself personally, for our entire global community of Wild Bum, and also for the trips for Wild Hive, I mean, that is what we're on a crusade to do, is right to help people recognize it's more than the pretty pictures that people post on Instagram. This is life-changing. This is immersing yourself in new cultures. It's broadening your perspective. You come home and you live with more inspiration, excitement. You have more solutions for things because, you know, you've just gained these eye-opening experiences. So,
well, exactly. And I mean, I remember back in my corporate day, we literally had reports of people that were going to max out on vacation and had unused vacations. Yeah. So this has been a hot topic for quite a while now.
Yes.
So I love this.
Yeah. And it's amazing that the number actually increases each year. You'd think it would be doing the opposite. Yeah. So yeah, it's very interesting. And that's really, so, you know, we have Wild Bum for Business, which is really exciting. And that's part of an employer adopting Wild Bum in their employee incentive and retention.
I was just going to ask about that because that's really cool because you can tell people to take vacation, but then
exactly
for someone who's not an experienced traveler or isn't comfortable, totally. How do they do that?
Yep. And that's just it. It's, you know, I think that it's wonderful when employers do recognize it and want to make that part of their culture, their workplace culture, but I think it takes it a step further to be able to say, no, actually, I want you to do it. And you don't need to sit and spend your time trying to figure out where to go, what to do, where to eat. You know, we want you to have these meaningful experiences. So here is a blueprint that has just saved you 10, 20 plus hours of your time. I think research shows that people, it's kind of two-part why they don't travel. One is that they might stress about their work you know, piling up.
Yep.
So I like to say that first and foremost, if you want a little vitamin T, I think it starts with courage. So you actually have to have the courage to go, to make the decision that you're going to prioritize travel. I've been talking a little bit recently with people about travel isn't really, it's not tangible. And our culture, right, is we're very focused on things and things we can see, right? So it's like to spend that money on something that you cannot see. It's an experience, right?
And I always tell my husband, I'm like, I don't need things. Exactly. I just want to travel. Yes. Like, I want to spend all my money on those experiences
you and have to not travel.
Yeah. And we've done that with our kids too when it comes to holidays and birthdays.
Exactly.
Give them the experience.
Yep. And I think that what people, because a lot of travel topics don't really touch on the health and wellness component, mm-hmm. people often don't realize what is happening for an adult, but especially for a child who, you know, they're still developing. So we not, you know, a lot of people, I get so like when people are like, a trip with my kid is not a vacation. But you don't understand what the gift that you're giving to them. And it's the gift that keeps on giving because you are shaping neural pathways in their brains. Mm-hmm. You are creating things that you might not see it right now, but you're shaping them into a well-rounded adult. Oh, right?
I love that. Couldn't agree more.
Yeah. So there's a lot that's happening with travel that we don't always realize. And I think it's always good to have the reminders. Because again, it goes much deeper and makes such a significant impact in our lives beyond what we might, you know, might realize. But yeah.
So Molly, we actually have to start wrapping up this interview. Sad. I think we're going to have you come back because there's so much more to talk about. Aww. But question, what does the art of living well mean to you?
Oh, well, that's definitely a personal mission of mine, really. Everything I do is involves the art of living well. I've created my passions into my businesses. So mm-hmm. I think that, thank you. Yeah, it's really, I think for me, and it goes even in Wildhive and Wild Bum, is that to me, the art of living well is about living authentically, which is such an overused word, but I think it's so important. Everything I do, I really want it to be organic. So, I think it's too long to really, we'll save more of that for next time. But I do think it's really, to tie in everything, it's really about living with more adventure and meaning, living with more wild and play and connection. Because at the end of the day, that's what this is all about. It's about making the world feel a little bit smaller. And I think something we didn't touch on earlier, because if you sit and you listen to the news and you listen to all of the fear-based, you know, stories that are out there, and then you start to travel, and whether it's the mini adventures around the Twin Cities, whether it's getting out of your bubble, or the big, you know, big travel experiences, you could go an hour away, you could go across the world, so it's everything, you realize that people are really good. And there's a lot of good stuff happening around the world. And I think we all need those reminders that humanity exists. And that, to me, is the art of living well.
Oh, I love that. That was so articulately said. So as we wrap up here, what's the main thing you want listeners to walk away with today? And maybe it's a tangible, you know, something that they can do today or tomorrow or this week.
Well, I would say there's a few things. One, there's nothing I love more than talking about travel and adventure and all these things. So always know that I am here to chat and to connect. So I hope that people leave feeling inspired to live with a little bit more adventure and play. I would love people to join our global family, global community. So I'd love to offer listeners 50% off of a Wild Bum travel guide.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Well, and I believe in what we're doing. The guide architects are crafting such quality, amazing, work, and it's their passion. So I would love to be able to share that with people. So if they want to email me at hello@wildbum.com and mention the podcast, I would love to get them signed up and offer the 50% off. So, and please, you know, check out wildbum.com. And then for Wildhive, join an adventure, mini or big. You can find all of the information at thewildhive.com. And yeah, I'd love to connect.
Awesome. And what about social media?
Oh yeah. We're on social media. Wildhive is all very grassroots and word of mouth. So everything is really posted on there. So the_wildhive on Instagram. We're on Facebook.
Hashtag wild bumming.
Yeah, wild bumming. Wild bumming is our movement of wild bumming happening all over the globe. You can find Wild Bum on social as well.
Great.
Thank you, Molly. Aww. We loved having you today.
I know. This was such an inspiring conversation.
Thank you. It's a treat for me. So thank you so much for having me.
Courtney and I are so excited to take our popular sugar workshop online. During this session, you'll learn what sugar is, the effect on your body. We'll learn how to deconstruct sugar cravings, and you'll understand why sugar addiction is real. Plus, we'll dive into some of the emotional triggers. You can join us by signing up on theartoflivingwell.us/programs. We have two upcoming sessions on November 20th and December 11th, both at 11:45 at Central Time, and both of those episodes will be recorded. We look forward to having you join us.
Thank you so much for listening to the Art of Living Well podcast. We are so grateful that you joined us today.
If you enjoyed this episode, please share it with a friend or anyone else you think may benefit from this information. We'd love for you to subscribe to our podcast, leave us a review, and tag the Art of Living Well podcast on social media.
If you want more inspiration in between episodes, you can find us on social media at theartofliving_well on Instagram and Facebook, where we will share snippets from our daily lives and our journey to living well.